Hi, everyone. My name is Olivier. I'm the founder and CEO of Actility. Today, I'm very excited to invite you to join our latest webinar on how to design LoRaWAN for dense deployments. More and more IoT devices are being added to the network in increasingly massive deployments. It is important to design IoT networks from the beginning with scalability requirements in mind. In this webinar, we will show different techniques based on learnings from past Actility deployments that can be used to design LoRaWAN networks for scalability. We will also show how densification leads to lower power consumption and therefore increases battery life and dramatically reduces the TCO for the end customer. Finally, we will look at how operators, whether mobile or fixed, can leverage their assets to deploy low-cost LoRaWAN picocells. After watching this webinar, you will learn the following. First, why adaptive data rate is key to LoRaWAN scaling. Second, how combination of macro and picocells is optimal to deliver both coverage and scalability. Three, the impact of network densification on capacity and device TCO in LoRaWAN networks. Fourth, how to deploy real-world water metering applications as an example of high-density scalability applications. And fifth, why microcellular networks, that is, networks that are based on very, very small cells and inexpensive hardware, are the future for LoRaWAN. And we'll briefly overview the ThinkPark product portfolio that addresses the challenges for densification of LoRaWAN deployments. With that intro, I have with me two other speakers. First one is Rohit, who is also working in Actility as product manager, and also Bill Versteeg, who is a well-known IoT consultant, the founder of jumpstartiot.com. And Bill will talk about some of the use cases and TCO analysis for both service providers and enterprises that will benefit from densification. So that is the agenda for this webinar. We'll begin by explaining why LoRaWAN is important to IoT. That will be brief. LoRaWAN overview as a primer for those of you who have not been exposed to LoRaWAN before. And then we'll go into more details on the LoRaWAN capacity analysis, following up with a case study and then wrapping up. So first of all, why are we doing this webinar? You know, why is LoRaWAN so important for the future of IoT? LoRaWAN is filling a gap in the wireless connectivity for both long range and long battery life. That is ultra, ultra low power for transmitting miles and miles away. The segments are many for this type of needs. You will see this detailed on the chart on the right side of the screen. You will notice that many of these use cases are fairly local use cases, like smart building, you need to cover a building or several buildings. Agriculture, you need to cover a farm. And immediately you can understand that with such local use cases, picocells that you deploy on the building or you deploy specifically for a farm might fill the gap. And later on in this webinar, we'll explain how this combined with macrocellular networks actually work very, very well together. Now let's do a very quick overview of the main characteristics of LoRaWAN technology. LoRaWAN is using a star type network architecture, so it's not based on mesh. There is no peer-to-peer communication. Every node communicates with a centralized applications, and there is a network server that is coordinating all radio communication. Something very important to understand in LoRaWAN is that the entire MAC layer is completely virtualized. So for the device, you're never attached to a given antenna. All the LoRaWAN antennas, they behave as the network, and vice versa, when the network communicates to final nodes, they will dynamically select this antenna or that antenna on a packet per packet basis. So the entire network behaves like one big giant virtual antenna. Security wise, LoRaWAN has a unique concept of end-to-end payload per customer, per device. And this payload is secured with a secret that is not known to the network server and the service provider. So you can provide LoRaWAN connectivity services without ever being able to decrypt the payload that is exchanged end to end. In terms of LoRaWAN devices, there are three big devices, big classes of devices. Class C is the simplest. It's a device that is powered, that is permanently listening to the network, and therefore uplink may happen at any time, and downlinks also from the network to device may be sent at any moment. At the other end of the spectrum, class A are devices that spend most of their life sleeping for battery conservation purposes. They wake up from time to time, and after a fixed delay after waking up, they open a very short reception slot, just trying to detect if there is radio communications towards them. And if so, of course, they will receive frames that are sent from the network to the device. But the rest of the time, they sleep. And therefore, this is a strategy called receiver-initiated transmission, where you first transmit, and that creates an opportunity for the network to send back downlinks to the device. This is obviously the most battery-efficient category of LoRaWAN communication. In the middle, you have Class B. Class B devices are synchronized with the network, and because they are synchronized with the network, they open periodic windows during which the network might send downlink communications. These windows are very efficient, they're extremely short, just enough time to sniff the air to find out if there is an incoming frame or not. So if you are not receiving any downlink, power consumption remains very low, but the latency of transmitting packets to Class B devices is improved because of these periodic slots, which are deterministic. The other very important thing to understand about LoRaWAN is the so-called adaptive data rate mechanism. The, this name is actually a simplification. LoRaWAN networks at any moment can control the data rate, but also the transmit power of devices and also the repeat rate, so how many times a given packet will be transmitted. But for now, let's look at the data rate itself. Intuitively, it is easy to understand that if you're transmitting at a fixed power and you are very far from the antenna, you can only transmit at a low bit rate, so that every bit is sent with a lot of energy in it because it takes a long time to transmit. Vice versa, if the same device is closer to the antenna, you will be able to transmit much faster because there is less energy that is required to reach the antenna. LoRaWAN, contrary to other technologies, is fully taking advantage of this. So if the device is far away from the antenna, the bitrate communication would be slow, and therefore the energy usage will be high. If you're closer to the antenna, bitrate will be higher, and energy will go down. You can see this on this chart, that as bitrate increases, the energy, the time on air spent, decreases. So the main objective of a LoRaWAN network server is to reduce energy consumption of nodes. So as much as possible, a device will be put at the fastest possible bitrate that still allows the device to communicate with the network. This is very important for the rest of the presentation to understand this viable bitrate mechanism that is so essential to LoRaWAN. This is a typical example of a LoRaWAN network where initially the service provider deployed macro cells. So this is this big hexagon here. And from macro cells, you're covering territory. But then you might not have a lot of capacity in this macro cell network because the cells are very large. If you're signing a smart parking deal or smart watering deal in a certain area, you may need additional capacity, or you may need additional coverage because there is some hard to reach devices, and at a specific location in the city, you need to densify your network. You can do this by means of picocells, which will cover smaller areas. And the way LoRaWAN works, if a device can be seen both by the macro cell network and the picocell, the network will find out because all antennas work together, and the network will increase the data rate of the device until the device communicates only with the picocell. So by doing this, LoRaWAN effectively increases the scale of the network by moving devices from the macro network to the pico network. We will see this in a much more quantitative way in the following slides. Because of this property of variable bitrate, capacity increase of LoRaWAN network is very, very simple. These networks, they have a frequency reuse of one, which means every cell is using the exact same communication channels. So you don't need to do any radio planning. You just decrease the space between antennas. In this example, you might have started a city deployment by putting antennas every 2 kilometers. After a while, you reach a capacity limit because you are doing a gas metering deployment in addition of an initial water metering deployment. The only thing you need to do is to drop in new base stations. So for instance, you would reduce the spacing between antennas from 2 kilometers to 1 kilometer. So you would reduce the cell radius from 1.5 to 700 meters. If you do this, the antennas get closer to devices. Therefore, bitrate increases. You can see this in the charts on the bottom right side of the screen, that the data rate distribution moves towards the faster data rates. And you will find that there are many good things that occur as you do this. You will double the capacity per cell. You will double the battery life of devices. And overall, because there are also more cells in your network, you will multiply the capacity of network by a factor of 10. So this increase of capacity is very efficient, very easy to do. The network self-reorganizes around the new antennas. Business-wise, LoRaWAN is very unique in that it allows collaboration between public premises networks. You need to rent space on top of buildings, deploy microcells, and so on. And on-prem networks, where you leverage the footprint of your own customers and you place base stations on the roof of your customers or in the buildings of your customers, or why not in B2C, you might place such modems in triple play modems and have many, many picocells in a given city. And you can leverage this, this graph currently on display compares the traditional public network deployment and the LoRaWAN optimized approach. In a traditional network approach, the last 10% of coverage are extremely, extremely costly. It is easy to cover the first 65%, 75% population, but then you go to the small villages, you go to the hard to reach places, and public networks become more and more expensive. Marginally, every percentage of coverage is costing more and more. With LoRaWAN, the typical approach is to cover an initial 60, 70% population, and then you will start receiving, as a service provider, lots of RFPs. Based on these RFPs for smart parking, for smoke detection, for water metering, you will be able to place additional picocells, additional base stations on the footprint owned by your customer. And of course, these base stations, they also serve the public network. So in a way, you are gaining free space, you are gaining free points of presence for your network. And the final few percentages of network coverage can be done with less capital outlay compared to traditional deployments. Another way to view this is if you do, for instance, a water metering network, there is always a few meters that will be very hard to reach. Instead of densifying the big network everywhere, you can place a little picocell only in the building that is posing problems. And with a small marginal addition of capital, you're solving the problem exactly where the reach problems occur, as opposed to doing big, massive, homogeneous densification of the network. So it's a very disruptive business model, which is creating a new cost point for many IoT use cases. With this, I leave the floor to Rohit for a much, much more quantitative approach to the same problems.
Hi, thanks Olivier. Next slide, please. Uh, Okay, so let's start with the link budget for LoRaWAN. As you can see here for the EU use case, especially the limiting link is the uplink, and the spreading factor that is limiting is of course SF12, which is the last spreading factor that you can use for 125 kilohertz. The transmit power that is allowed in the EU is about 16 dBm, and with the gateway receiver sensitivity of about minus 140 dBm, you arrive at a link budget of 161 dB. And what is interesting to note here is that when you compare this to EU, for EU versus India and US, the link budget is much higher because of the higher regulation in the transmit power. And you can find the details of this study in the white paper that is mentioned in the link below. Next slide, please. Now, if I look at the link budget comparison of LoRaWAN versus cellular IoT, it's very easy to see from this figure, this chart, basically, that LoRaWAN is very comparable to NB-IoT, and it's much better than LTE-M. So, and it should be also noted that for NB-IoT, you need at least 64 repetitions to achieve this 164 dB link budget, which means that it really consumes a lot of power when you're using NB-IoT for at the cell edge. So here are the deployment parameters for the LoRaWAN. So basically what we did was we did a study based on the simulator that was initially developed by University of Lancaster, and we extended it and we improved it based on the learnings that we carried out in Actility over the last few years based on the deployments we carried out worldwide. So as you can see here, the Europe has about 16 channels maximum, and for US there are even more channels, at least 72 in uplink and 8 in downlink, which means that the US has even more capacity. The uplink cell edge data rate for LoRaWAN, we varied it from SF7 to SF12, which means that you can target different data rates as you shrink or enlarge the cells. We use a 10% packet error rate for the effective packet error rate. Then for the number of transmissions, we, for this purpose of the study, we took it from 1 to 3 transmissions, and I'll show you how retransmissions can actually significantly improve capacity. The devices were located in indoor daylight scenario, and the transmit power was set to 16 dBm. And for the purpose of this study, this is an uplink-only study where the payload size was about 20 bytes, and the number of uplink packets per day per device was set to 48, which is very reasonable for most of the applications. Then for, now let's look at some of the results for the single cell deployment. So what you see here is a blue curve, which basically refers to the static spreading factor, and each point on the x-axis refers to the spreading factor setting from SF7 to SF12. For example, the number of gateways per kilometer square, when you see 0.37, it basically refers to SF12 cell edge data rate, then to SF11, 10, and so on and so forth. The orange curve basically refers to the fact that when you apply ADR, instead of using a fixed SF, you can actually double the capacity, especially at higher gateway scenarios. And this is due to the fact that LoRaWAN has orthogonal spreading factors. And also there's a effect called capture effect, which means that when two or more packets collide, there's a good possibility that at least one of them can be recovered, especially if they're orthogonal and there's a power difference between them. Next slide, please. Now let's look at what happens when you're deploying multiple cells. So the previous results were for a single cell. Now as you deploy more and more cells, as Olivier mentioned, that the same packet in LoRaWAN can be received by multiple antennas because all the network intelligence lies on the network side in the LRC, which means that as you densify the network, the green, the blue curve and the orange curve diverge significantly at higher densities, and you can have up to 4 times gain with the so-called macro diversity effect, because the same packet is being received by multiple antennas. So you can see here that when you densify the network, the macro diversity can actually improve the capacity by additional 4 times based on what you saw before. Now, what happens with retransmissions? So retransmissions can be used for 2 ways. One way to use retransmission is to improve the reliability of the network. Let's say if I send a packet with 10% packet error rate, and I send it again 2 more times, then my packet error rate at the end would be 0.1%. That's one way to improve to use retransmissions for reliability. Another way to use retransmissions when you want to improve the capacity of the network is to say my target packet error rate is 10%. So I send each packet, let's say, by 0.50% probability of error. If I multiply 0.5 by 3 times, you will see that your target packet error rate would be about 12.5%. So what this means is that when you're transmitting packet at higher packet error rate for each transmission, what this does is that it allows you to use lower spreading factors or lower the transmit power. So what this does is, if you look at the curve between the blue and the orange for the lower gateway densities, you can see that the retransmissions can actually have up to 5 times impact on the capacity at lower gateway densities. Okay, now let's take a look at how battery lifetime improves when you densify the network. So for the purpose of this study, we assume the 5 watt-hour battery capacity. And of course, this is only uplink and does not include the downlink power consumption, MCU, or a sensor power consumption. So what you can see here is, as you densify the network, there's at least 10 times improvement in the battery lifetime. So what is important here is not the absolute nature of the curve, but relative nature of the curve, which means that as you densify the network, you dramatically improve the battery lifetime of an end device, which has an impact on TCO, as I'll show you in the next slides. Okay, so let's take a look at how battery lifetime impacts a 10-year TCO. Now, if I'm assuming there's a water rate gas metering, and a lot of times these meters are located in indoor basements, which are very hard to reach. If I'm assuming the battery replacement is a campaign, and that campaign is costing me $30 per meter, which includes identification, collection, replacement, and dispatch, assuming that there are about 100K meters, which is a very conservative number because there can be at least millions of them in a city like Paris, you can see here is that as you go from 1 year battery replacement, which means that you have to replace the battery 10 times over the period of 10 years, to replacing the battery every one time in only 10 years, you can have 10x impact on OPEX on the TCO. And this really has a very dramatic impact for an end customer or an enterprise deployment for water and gas metering application. Now, how does power consumption and TCO interact with each other? So as you all know, the number of sensors would be much, much higher than the number of gateways. And the sensor cost is the primary driver for overall TCO. Now, when you're trying to deploy high volume LoRaWAN or any other technology sensors, most of the component costs would actually go down dramatically when you are using high volume manufacturing process as the technology matures. But for the battery cost, since the batteries are already used by other applications, they are already a high volume component. So what happens is when you have low volumes, the battery cost is roughly 1/5 of the total cost of a typical sensor. Now in high volumes, because the other component costs have gone down, the battery cost basically is half or more of the overall sensor cost, which means that battery cost is one of the main drivers that contributes to the overall TCO. So this implies that if I have to reduce the cost of the battery, I need to lower the power consumption of the sensor, which results in the shrinkage of the size of the battery. So the power consumption, battery lifetime, and TCO, they are intricately linked to each other. So here's the conclusion of the analysis that we did. The LoRaWAN capacity actually scales dramatically with densification, and it can keep going on indefinitely as long as you use ADR and intelligent algorithms that significantly reduce the power consumption of the network. Now, when you use ADR, microdiversity, and retransmissions, you can have, at least in this study, the gain of up to 73 times, and you can receive even more gain if you further densify the network. And as you saw in the study, that LoRaWAN battery lifetime again has a significant increase of up to 10 times due to densification. And again, that results in up to 10x reduction in the TCO using appropriate design choices and the smart ADR algorithms. And it should be noted that the US has even more uplink channels compared to EU, which means there's even more room to play with the capacity, which can be used to reduce the power consumption of the network. So the key message from this section of the web slide deck was that you can use appropriate network design and ADR algorithms to achieve lower power consumption, lower TCO, and to improve the network scaling. So with that, I hand it over to Bill.
Thanks, Rohit. Talk for a moment about some North American examples of how to apply this in the real world. Some of what we're talking about here is North American specific, but most of it does apply to the rest of the world. So when we compare a sparse tower-based network to a dense femtocell-based network, we find that the there are different classes of device. The tower-based gateways require you to lease space on the towers, climb the tower, do zoning, and pull power to it, and perhaps even running backhaul to it. If an operator has an existing deployment that already deploys customer premise equipment or other types of devices into the field, the operator can choose to put a very small device in. It's a low-cost bill of materials that leverages the ongoing installation. You're already sending a truck out to install this thing, or the customer is buying this thing at retail and they're installing it. So imagine putting a LoRaWAN gateway into a Wi-Fi hotspot or a TV or a cable modem or a thermostat. The engineering challenge is not that hard. You have to add a very small 7 centimeters by 3 centimeter 8-channel reference design. There are a couple places that you can get these commercially. You have to add about 3 watts of power to the overall design, and perhaps the most difficult challenge is getting rid of the 3 watts of heat from that device. Once you have that design in place, you can deploy about 100 times as many gateways for about 1/10 as much capital. Next slide, please. So if we look at the use case of a water meter deployment, in particular a water meter deployment in North America, when you go to do facilities-based deployments to cover water meters, you end up with a 4 kilometer tower spacing. This is highly dependent upon the geography you're in, if it's urban or rural and how hilly it is. But for the purpose of this example, let's use 4 kilometer tower spacing. You tend to hit one or two gateways at one packet a day at spreading factor 10 and 27 dBm. You have to deploy 64 channel gateways in order to send at high power in North America. So the gateways are pretty expensive and you have to do a high-end sensor. If on the other hand, you can go with a femto-based gateway, the density of the network is driven by the opportunistic devices themselves. In urban environments, a given operator tends to have customers every 30 meters or so. You don't really need to put a gateway in every customer's home. You would target to have a gateway every 200 meters or so, perhaps 100 meters. Given that density, you can design your sensor to hit 10, 20 gateways at spreading factor 7 and 17 dBm. And we'll show what that does to our power budget. Next slide, please. So let's say we put 100,000 water meters out there and we want to calculate how long it takes, our costs over the first 5 years of the network deployment. Clearly, we designed the battery to last 10 or 20 years, but let's just talk about the five-year network cost. So we, on a per-region basis, you can go figure out what it costs to put 20 macro gateways on leased towers. And once you have that cost, you work backwards into how much of that money you can save by going with femto-based gateways. So for the five-year cost of 20 tower-based gateways, given today's costing for the components to make an 8-channel gateway, you could install, as many as 120,000 femto gateways. Turns out you don't need 120,000 femto gateways to cover a typical 100,000 water meter deployment. 10K is really, really robust coverage. So if you do the math, you save 80% of the network build by doing a femto gateway, by 10K femto gateways rather than 20 macro gateways. Next slide, please. So now that you have a comparison between what it costs to build a tower-based deployment versus a femto-based deployment, What does that do, in addition to the cost savings of building the network using femtocells, what does that do to your sensor cost? Remember, of course, that there's going to be a lot more sensors in the field than gateways, and that's where a lot of the cost of the system is. So when you do a tower-based gateway, you design to operate at 2 kilometers. You end up with having to send at 27 dBm, which adds roughly $10 of cost per water meter by the time you add in the cost of the higher power RF front end and the much larger battery. 100K meters times 10K each, $100 million extra cost in the first 5 years of your water meter deployment. On the other hand, when you are much closer to the, when the sensor is much closer to a gateway because you have 10,000 gateways in the field, your sensors are between 30 meters and 200 meters to the gateway. So the sensor can dial the power down. It can also spend a short amount of time on air because it's at spreading factor 7. This saves you both battery and it saves you the expensive front end, which gives you the lower design cost. So the net is you save about $1 million on the water meters themselves. When you think about the additional verticals that get layered in, you find that you save on the water meters, you would save on gas meters, you would save on temperature monitoring, you would save on cold chain. All of your sensors can have lower batteries, so the savings keeps paying every time you instantiate a new vertical. So as seen by a large operator that has some incumbency in the field, most network operators provide data service to about a third of the households in their coverage area. So they pass every home in a region, and then they sell either cable modem or a DSL or fiber to the home to about a third of them. In dense urban environments, you know, large cities, the distance between a given operator subscribers is 30 meters. Imagine you're in the city of Paris, and you look out, and behind every third window, there's either a cable modem or a DSL modem. If you could manufacture each of those devices to have this very low-cost LoRaWAN radio in there, you'd have really, really good coverage. But it turns out you don't need that dense of coverage. You would have more coverage than you could possibly need. So you work backwards to a lower phase penetration that leads to either 100-meter or 200-meter gateway penetration. Given the fact that the five-year cost for femto gateway is about 5,000 times lower than a tower-based gateway, you would end up with, pick a number, 50,000 femto gateways rather than the 10 tower-based gateways. I'd rather have 50,000 gateways in the field than 10 gateways in the field. This is particularly true if you can opportunistically get at least 10 femto gateways installed at the top of residential buildings. If you can take the population of your subscribers and think about where they live, in most urban environments, there are 20, 30, 50-story buildings, and if you serve one or two customers in the top two or three floors of those buildings, you get roughly equivalent coverage with just those 10 gateways as your 10 towers, and then you multiply that times several thousand. Now, some of the gateways are going to be mounted in the basement, and you're not going to get good coverage from it, but you're still going to get a couple hundred meters. Next slide, please. So, where would one deploy these dense deployment models? If you have outdoor facilities, in other words, if you're already deploying Wi-Fi hotspots on your pole infrastructure or in your commercial customers, or if you have access to hanging equipment on the strand, the cable that's between telephone poles in urban environments, you could put these gateways into strand-based power supplies or strand-based amplifiers. Next slide, please. Alternatively, if you have the opportunity to deploy indoor gateways, you can identify the target markets that you want to serve and deploy a bespoke indoor gateway. Let's say you want to provide a cold chain to the quick service restaurant environment. You would deploy a bespoke low-cost gateway into those customers, and from those customers you would get inside to outside coverage to additional use cases. And that's a little spotty. That would help fill the gaps. A more attractive financial deployment model is if you're a network operator and you can opportunistically deploy gateways into cable modems, DSL modems, or Wi-Fi routers. You get down to that 30-meter max density possibilities. The other way to do it is if you're an equipment vendor, if you sell at retail, you sell Wi-Fi extenders or personal assistants, Amazon Echo, Google Home, et cetera, or even TVs or any device that you sell at retail, for a relatively small BOM cost, you can establish footprint in the IoT community. Next slide. So in many respects, the future of LoRaWAN networks is in microcells. We talked about the financial advantages, but in addition to the financial advantages, macro diversity requires three key benefits. It increases capacity. Once again, I'd rather have 50,000 8-channel gateways than 10 64-channel gateways. You get just a lot more coverage. And because the coverage tends to be closer to the sensors, where in a sparse network environment, you would have the likelihood of two transmitters at the same power being equidistant from a single gateway, a single tower. They're 2 kilometers apart and they happen to be equidistant from the only tower they can hit. Those collisions would probably lead to packet loss. If, however, those same sensors that are 2 kilometers apart are transmitting at much lower power and hitting gateways that are within a couple hundred meters of it, each gateway will have a different collision domain, and the packets will not interfere. And last but not least, we talked about the economic advantages of having lower power consumption on the end devices. Next slide. We'll turn it back.
Okay. Thanks, Bill. So I think by now you're all convinced on the benefits of picocells and why this is the future for LoRaWAN networks. It's not necessarily either or. What you will find in this graph here is, I think, the illustration of the collaboration between macro cell networks and picocell networks. When you're a service provider, the first thing that customers will ask you is coverage maps. If you want to quickly build an attractive coverage map, then macro cells are a good solution if you can get access to rooftops. But most likely, you will not dimension the macro cell network for the full capacity required by use cases, because that would be too expensive. As Bill explained, every macro gateway on top of a roof is fairly expensive, so you want to place as little as needed by the coverage map, not the capacity. The capacity will be brought by additional picocells. In this example, you add them to street lighting, which is a very realistic example. Many cities are now upgrading their street lighting to LEDs, and many new LED controllers now leverage LoRaWAN, especially the LoRaWAN multicast capabilities for control. These locations, you are fairly high above street level. You're also powered, so it's an ideal location for a picocell. But again, as Bill was saying, there are many, many other opportunities to deploy picocells in set-top boxes, in white goods, TVs, and so on. So the benefits of this collaboration between macro and micro are, again, reduced TCO for the operator, reduced TCO for enterprises, because lifetime of devices on the same battery becomes higher, and battery replacement is a key component of the TCO for IoT. On this diagram, you will see also a roaming hub, the small blue cloud on the left. This is a reminder that roaming in LoRaWAN is super easy and super democratic. You know, unlike traditional cellular network roaming, where if you are not a public operator, you cannot get into the community, roaming in LoRaWAN is possible between enterprise networks, public networks, between enterprise networks. So if you or in this mood to collaborate with other networks, which is extremely positive for IoT, as was demonstrated before, it's very easy for an enterprise that has several sites to collaborate with other enterprises. A typical case is for logistics. If you're owning warehouses in half of the country and you can roam with the warehouses of someone else that has warehouses in the other half of the country, together you get full coverage. And this example translates to many, many other use case examples. So what to do with all this in practice when you are designing a network? As Rohit explained, the graphs that were used in this webinar are extracted from a time domain simulation tool. It's a complex tool that took several years to be tuned and can be used only by experts. In the field, you want to use something that is easier and faster. We use the time-based tool to calibrate a much easier tool that is presented here. We call it the Air Interface Dimensioning Tool. So by means of calibration, we have, first of all, introduced typical propagation models for RF, depending on where you are, if it's density, scarcity, countryside, and so on. And we have also calibrated the densification effect on capacity, depending on the size of cell. So using this tool, if you request your Actility professional services, you can easily enter the main parameters for where you're planning a deployment. Is it the middle of a US city or a small green village in France? Based on it, decide what is the density that you require, you know, how many meters, how many smoke detectors, how many moist detectors in the field, and so on. And then dimension your cells to reach the optimal capacity at minimum TCO. So this tool is easy to use, provides immediate results, and is typically what you will need to then feed 3D models. You know, once you know that the average distance between antennas that you want is 1 kilometer, then you turn to actual maps to find the towers, to locate them, and use 3D models. So this is a very useful prep tool for planning a dense deployment. This slide describes roaming, which is a completely different topic, but just so that everyone is in the audience is aware of the possibilities of roaming in LoRaWAN. Networks can collaborate not only in either or fashion as in cellular. In cellular, you need to choose a network, and then you will use only the antennas of that network. In LoRaWAN, there is a mechanism called passive roaming, where the coverage of networks sum up. So if you have passive roaming with several networks, virtually your own network will have the sum of antennas of all networks, which is why if you have collaborations of picocells, macrocells, and enterprise network, you can foresee how LoRaWAN can become ubiquitous network present everywhere with a very, very good link budget and therefore high bitrate. It's a bit ironic that we are all describing LoRaWAN as low bitrate technology because everyone has the cell edge, the worst case in mind. But the future of LoRaWAN is not so low bitrate. I foresee the dense LoRaWAN networks as having maybe average bitrate of a kilobits per second, which is much, much, much better, of course, for battery life. So in Actility, we provide the various tools to achieve such deployments. ThinkPark Wireless is the main product for service providers. We have worked many years on optimal ADRs, adaptive data rate algorithms. ThinkPark Wireless computes in real time the characteristics of the RF interface, the fading effects, and so on, and dynamically will consider macro diversity, receive power to select the optimum transmit power, to select the optimum data rate, and to select the optimum repeat factor. The quality of this algorithm is often overlooked. You know, when you do early trial, basically anything will work. But when you start doing very dense deployments with millions of meters, the quality of this adaptive data rate mechanism is absolutely key to the TCO and the stability of your network. We also supply a smaller scale product for enterprises. It can be fairly big enterprises, but this is your own infrastructure serving your warehouse or your warehouses, your retail, and so on. And the two, as outlined before, can collaborate. To this purpose, we have online service called ThinkPark Exchange. which can act as default route for your network. So any frame that you receive and do not understand can be sent to ThingPark Exchange. And vice versa, of course, if one of your sensors is roaming in a network that is covered by ThingPark Exchange, you will receive the packets. And that's how we get a collective benefit by summing network coverage. So the key takeaways for this presentation, which was also a very dense presentation, but this is a complex topic. One, LoRaWAN networks, they can scale almost indefinitely with densification. You add antennas, you increase bit rate, you can grow your LoRaWAN network, and it's as simple as dropping base stations where you need them, and the picocells can be, you know, sub-$100, very inexpensive type of hardware. Network capacity can improve, you know, almost 100 times compared to basic coverage-only network. The benefit is for battery lifetimes, and that means reduced TCO. When you do a gas meter, a water meter, or any type of deployment where changing batteries is key, the TCO is really what you want to have if you want to be the winner infrastructure for this type of networks. Fifth point is collaboration. You know, LoRaWAN is a network that was designed from the ground up with the perspective of collaboration in mind. The LoRa Alliance did not want to end up in the same situation as Wi-Fi today, where you have millions and millions of Wi-Fi access points, but they don't collaborate, and therefore they are pretty much useless in most cases when you want to connect to the network and you are just, you know, somewhere away from home. With LoRaWAN, we have this idea that most networks should collaborate for the common benefit of coverage, of course, but also battery life. And the key to all this is network design that is managed in an optimal way. And the algorithms behind it is called the ADR, which is, as you understood by now, a simple name for something that is much more complex, that will need to play with macro diversity, with repeat factor, with power, and also data rate, all of this optimized simultaneously. If you want to get demos or more information on this, you can contact Actility pre-sales. Guy is available to get your questions, and based on where you are, you will be dispatched to the local experts. And with that, after that long session, I'm sure you have questions, so I want to open the floor for questions. Thank you for your attention.